يعني البلد كأبناء الإنسان مثل أبنائي يعني كأني فقدت واحد من أولادي. البلد بلد الإنسان بعد بلده ما بيسمع.
Didn't have bad health to begin with. You're certainly going to get it here.
It will cost him about 1,200. It's a disaster.
هن أولادي هن الدنيا كلها تبعي. أماني إنه يكون إنهم مستابة إنه ما يضيعوا بالدوام اللي إحنا هلا نحنا فيها.
This is a huge, huge piece of this war that it's easy to forget about.
After war began in Syria, I've come to an unofficial refugee camp in neighbouring Lebanon. I see the kids first. I used to be just like them, running around with other Syrian kids many years ago.
كيفك؟ كويسة؟ قديش عمرك؟ قديش عمرك أنت؟
64.
Little Khadija is 4 years old, the same age I was when my family left Syria, but in entirely different circumstances. كيفك يا خديجة؟
عربي.
My family left Syria because my parents wanted a better life for their children. The kids in this camp are nowhere near as lucky. Stuck in a land that doesn't want them, everything in short supply.
بدها مي في مي
Khadija is one of more than half a million Syrian kids who fled to Lebanon officially. Unofficially, there could be twice as many. Lebanon hosts more refugees per capita than any other country, which is why the government stopped counting Syrian refugees a few years ago, unable to cope with the influx.
I grew up in Syria, never expecting it to descend into the chaos that we're seeing today. And when you look around the camps, just like these that are dotted all around Lebanon, it's really heartbreaking because there are children just like Khadija and all these kids around us now who are missing out on the basics that were available to them in a country like Syria.
With no end to the war in sight, Syrians, young and old, are dying from treatable and preventable diseases. I wonder how you stay alive, let alone stay hopeful, as your old life slides further and further away. Australian paediatrician Annie Sparrow doesn't claim to have all the answers.
You didn't have bad health to begin with. You're certainly going to get it here.
Every year she comes to Lebanon to help in any way she can. She's an expert in humanitarian health crises. This year she's already visited half a dozen times.
I was working on the war maybe 5 years ago. I thought it would be for about a year. But I've come back because I can help in many ways to meet the need that they have. And I come back because the Syrians themselves are fantastic and I love to work with them.
We're heading to the Bekaa Valley, home to an estimated 1 million Syrian refugees. In truth, no one knows the real number. Many of the refugees are undocumented, which means they can't legally work, send their kids to school, or travel within the valley to get healthcare.
Given that, you know, none of the refugee camps here are official, so they're not run the way that Zaatari or the other camps are in Jordan, where their service is set up. So the burden of child health is huge, and same for adults too. I mean, imagine they have all the problems of the first world. So chronic diseases we know, diabetes, heart disease, high blood pressure, cancer, and they have all these problems that we think of developing countries. The malnutrition, the infectious disease, the typhoid, hepatitis, dysentery. And on top of that, they have all the trauma of war.
While the international aid community is bogged down in bureaucracy, Annie tells me about the thousands of Syrians losing hope because they can't get basic medicine for common diseases like diabetes. On our first house call, we're about to meet a diabetic patient. We're being introduced by a local aid worker, Dr. Bashir Al-Khatib. Asra is 17.
Asra, it's me, Annie. Anna Tabibi. Thank you.
We're surrounded by Middle Eastern hospitality, and Asra slowly opens up about her struggle with diabetes.
So even though it was difficult, you could still access treatment and you had no problems.
After 3 years as a refugee in Lebanon, Asra's once manageable diabetes could now see her lose something very precious.
It's often very hard because the eyes are not equal, and because the poor blood sugar control means that there's often blurriness. But, you know, her vision is going to change from day to day, particularly if she's not getting regular insulin.
That Asra has had to ration her insulin since she came to Lebanon highlights a health system that can't cope. In their bare living room, no one can bring themselves to talk about the future. And what must be Asra's biggest fear, whether she'll lose her sight altogether. The strain shows, especially on her mother. With heavy hearts, we leave Asra and her family.
The thing that really worried me about meeting Asra was obviously her diabetes is having a massive impact on her life, but you could tell that her mental health was also affected by it.
Of course, it's entirely normal to be depressed. It's catastrophic. She's losing her sight, which is just about the most precious thing that we all have. And she knows it's disappearing faster. And we watched her. It's blurry. It's deteriorating. And without that, she has a 17-year-old girl whose future is not just dim right now. It's dark and it's terrifying.
Annie has come to the end of her visit to Lebanon, but I plan to meet Asra again tomorrow at a doctor's clinic, where hopefully she'll get more news about the state of her eyesight.
Dozens of people. There's clearly a lot of need in this area.
I find Dr. Bashir Al-Khatib, who was with us at Asra's apartment. Today, he's running around trying to deal with all these patients.
So how many patients do you see here every day?
I think here and every day we have between 150 to 200 patients.
Wow.
This clinic is run by Syrians, for Syrians. Bishr also had to flee war, but instead of immigrating further away, he chooses to stay close by in Lebanon to help his fellow Syrian refugees.
People trust more the Syrian physicians because they are the same culture. They are their doctors inside Syria, and now when they come here, still the same doctors, and still they know their patients.
Bishr is about to see Asra. Inside the consultation room, we find her and her mum putting on brave faces. Asra's type 1 diabetes means her body doesn't produce insulin. A finger prick test will let doctors know how bad things are.
I think it's 2040 here. This minute, it's a hyperglycemic, yeah.
Asra's blood sugar levels are more than double what they should be.
She's fasting, so it's a high number for the fasting blood glucose.
Oh, really?
Yeah, 240.
What should it be?
It should be below 125.
Wow, okay.
Yeah. It's a fasting blood glucose, so it's really high. Yeah.
So that's a dramatic increase. What does that mean?
That means she's not controlling her disease. كري بيعمل هو طبعا هالأمراض هي بيأثر بشكل أساسي على. So Dr. Ramiz was telling us that because of diabetes, she gets an injury in his retina, so in her eyes. She had a bleeding and hemorrhage in both eyes, the left and the right eyes. The left eyes is more hemorrhagic than the right one. She is seen by an ophthalmologist and she is needed a surgery in both eyes. The problem that the surgery cost is high. Each eye needed like $4,500.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's a big amount of money for refugees.
$9,000 to fix Asra's eyesight, an impossible amount of money for her family. Now I understand why no one was talking about the future yesterday.
The situation will be deterioration, and she will be blind at all.
كيف عيونك هلا؟ وهلا بدك تروحي على البيت شو بدك تعملي؟
بدي اروح على البيت اقعد في البيت بس اقدم بدي صلي.
Asra may have escaped the bombs of Syria, but for so many chronically sick Syrian kids like her, surviving in Lebanon is becoming just as uncertain. Another diabetic child of war arrives at the clinic, and he's not well at all. In fact, the blood test reveals 14-year-old Aboudi is minutes away from slipping into a coma. They rush to put him on a glucose strip.
How long does this process take?
This will take like 15 minutes or 10 minutes.
Okay. Yeah. And then after about 15 minutes, his blood glucose levels will return to normal?
Yeah, it should be like more normal.
So he's pretty lucky that something like this happened here?
Yeah, he's so lucky because we can just manage it immediately.
What would happen if he was at home?
If he didn't notice that and his parents didn't notice that, he maybe got in coma.
Wow.
Yeah.
This simple glucose strip is potentially saving Aboudi's life. But it turns out his unusually pale skin is a sign of another problem.
If he didn't control his blood glucose well, the kidney failure may be worse and he may go through the hemodialysis. Yeah, and hemodialysis for refugees in Lebanon, it's a disaster. It will cost him about $1,200 or $300 per month.
As refugees, Aboudi's family will never be able to afford dialysis for their son.
He may can stay for a week or 2 weeks without dialysis, but then he may die.
So we're talking about life or death situation.
Okay, yes, that's it.
Aboudi's dad arrives just after the drama has passed.
Yeah, it's a life or death situation.
I wonder if frightening moments like these are just part of life for the family. It turns out Aboudi and his dad Mahmoud share the burden of diabetes together. Mahmoud also has type 1 diabetes. Both father and son have an easily treatable condition, but one of them is losing the battle.
Kifak. Kifak, Hamimi. Marhaba. Kifak, Abouda. How are you, sir? Eh? I'm tacos. It's good. Taban, let's have a look. كيف حسيت حالك قبل؟
دخلت بالقاع مع شوية جعت كثير.
It's good to see Abouda eating now with his family. They've got rice, potatoes and some yogurt. Much better now than he was when we saw him at the hospital earlier, which was pretty scary. كويس صرتمو؟ أحسن من قبل؟
Their meal is high in carbohydrates, not ideal for a diabetic. In all likelihood, it's because they have no choice. Most of their meagre income goes towards rent on this apartment. Mahmoud takes me up to the rooftop for a quiet talk. The shadow of their past life looms over them constantly. Syria is just a few kilometres away.
Darfi, Syria hon sara.
Hey hon.
Hey hon Syria.
Syria. شو تفكر إن تفرج هون؟
شو فكر يعني بتمنى حال إني طير بكون بسوريا.
آه
يعني كنا بسوريا عايشين مبسوطين الحمد لله. يعني بلا ماخذ على اذا مرض ولد مثلا باخذ الولد على اي مشفى اي شيء ببلاش يعني ما بياخذ منه عمله الشيء مامن موفر للطلاب موفر لكل شيء للمدارس اي شيء موفر لنا يعني دواء بلاش كل شيء يعني الحمد لله كنا مبسوطين يعني هي جيت الحقيقه الصعبه كثير الانسان بيشوف بلده تتدمر يعني البلد كابناء الانسك مثل ابنائي يعني كاني فقدت واحد من اولادي بلد بلد الإنسان بعد بلد ما بيسوى شيء. أنا إذا اضطر الأمر لغسيل الكلى أول شيء أنا يعني بدي أغسل الكلى يعني بالأخير يعني لابد منه وبالنسبة للمصاري ما فيني أدفع مصاري نهائيا يعني.
You can almost see the weight on his shoulders. While Lebanon struggles to treat chronic diabetics like Abouda and Asra, there's potentially a much bigger crisis looming, the threat of contagious disease. So while Lebanon may not want Syrian refugees to stay, it knows it can't ignore them.
It can't be easy staying healthy in camps like these. Just seen some open sewage right by a tent, someone's home. There are kids running around everywhere playing with anything they find. It must be a real challenge to raise a family here.
Oh, yeah. One of the little girls I meet in the camp leads me to her family's tent.
Marhaba. Marhaba, kifak? Ana Sara ismi. Ahlan wa sahlan. Marhaba. Kifkon? Kifkon? Hi.
Sham is one of five children being raised alone by her mother Nisreen, a widow.
In the 5 years that you've been in Lebanon, has anyone in the family been sick?
Eh, بس أمراض يعني عادية. يعني الحمد لله مو إنه وصلنا لمرحلة كبيرة يعني. يعني ريان أولادي. فأنا عالجت عندي بطريقتي التمر أهم شغلة للريان.
Keeping kids physically healthy is hard enough. Gauging their mental health must be even more difficult. Nisreen says her older kids, who knew a life before the war, seem to be coping. It's her younger kids she worries about most, like Sham.
Hi, Sam.
إن الحرب أثرت علي وعلى أولادي شيء إيجابي وشيء سلبي. مو كل شيء سلبي، إيجابي إني أنا قويت وصار شخصيتي أقوى، بدي حافظ على أولادي. سلبي إنه أنا طلعت من بلدي وتغربنا، وضعنا يعني هيك متاهات هالدنيا، بعدتنا عن أهلنا وبلدنا. هن أولادي، هن الدنيا كلها تبعي. أمالي إنه يكون لهم مستقبل، إنه ما يضيعوا بالدوام اللي إحنا هلا نحن فيها. بتمنى ياخذوا حقوقهم يعني مثل باقي كل الأولاد، يدرسوا ويطلعوا شيء يعني، ويسكنوا لو إنه ببيت مثلاً. حاجتهم يعني حلم الخيمة صار علينا صعب كثير. يعني صار يعني الصغيرة صارت تقلي ماما ليش نحن ما بنسكن البيت؟ يعني هاي أنا كثير بزعل وبنقهر عليها.
Even though Syria still dominates the news headlines, Syria's refugees in Lebanon are very much a forgotten people. And Lebanon has become a land of lost Syrian dreams. Asra tells me what she would do if she could see properly.
إذا كان فيني شوف بروح على المدرسة بتعلم بقرأ قصص بتفرج على التلفزيون بنقي على الأقل ثيابي لحالي لما بدي. أنا بحب المدرسة كثير وأنا كنت بتمنى إني أكون مدرسة أدرس الأطفال وأعتني فيهم كمان، هيك كنت بحب أكون. بس ما في شيء من هدول الشغلات عم يصير معي. لأشوف بعيوني لأنه أنا صبية بعمري لازم أكون شوف بعيوني، بس ما عم أقدر أشوف.
Coming to Lebanon and meeting Mahmoud, I think about the worries all Syrian fathers must have. My father got the life he was hoping for his children when we left Syria years ago. I'm not sure Mahmoud gets to dream that big anymore.
وشو بدي احكي يعني، وهم كبير وعائلة كبيرة ومعاش خفيف ما في يعني. هي ابني مريض، هي أهم شيء، أهم من المصاري إنه ابني مريض. أهم من المصاري، ثاني شيء إنه مصاري ما في. إيش بدي أحكي؟